بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون وقال تعالى فلولا نفر من كل فرقة طائفة منهم ليتفقهوا في الدين ولينذروا قومهم إذا رجعوا إليهم لعلهم يحذرون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. So my dear brothers and sisters, so alhamdulillah, in the last time I taught you about different sects and also explained the meaning of Iman and Islam. Today inshallah we are going to teach you Usul al-Fiqh. And Usul al-Fiqh basically is Usul of the Fiqh. So we have to understand what the Fiqh means. As there have been big misunderstanding, you know, for many, you know, centuries in Islam about Iman Islam. And I last time explained to you that Iman has been reduced to Aqidah and Islam has been reduced to Madhab and, you know, Madhab and opinions. So similarly, you know, Fiqh, basically there is misunderstanding of the Fiqh. Fiqh has been, you know, for, you know, many hundred years, for many people, Fiqh means some minor issues. So, you know, a small thing that people think about fiqh means really that, you know, how to, you know, in buying and selling minor issues, you know, about wudu, you know, how many sunnah are there and how many mustahab are there in the wudu, you know, things which are very, very minor, that what people think is the fiqh. And that's why you can see most people, when they say fiqh, they cannot understand, since they don't know what fiqh means, so they always think fiqh must be with one of the school. So if you say, do you study fiqh, the people will ask you, which fiqh? Hanafi or Maliki or Shafi or Hanbali, you can see people actually have no idea what fiqh means. They think actually this is what fiqh means, minor issues. So and this actually, this meaning of the fiqh, which people have in their mind, does not exist in the Quran and does not exist in the Sunnah and does not exist in the first few hundred years of Islam. I mean, that fiqh does not exist in the time of Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi and Hanbal. That fiqh has become actually very late, not very early period. So that we have to understand what really fiqh means. As I mentioned last time very clearly, that the meaning of the aqidah, which has become so dominant, and people think if you don't have aqidah, you cannot be a believer, this has been very, very late. Otherwise, you know, all the messengers, all the prophets, the Quran, the sunnah, the only thing you learn is iman. If people have iman, then they're believers. If they don't have iman, they don't have believers. And if they have iman, they need to have Islam. Iman makes, you know, necessary that people must have Islam. So similarly, actually, for a long, long time, people didn't actually get the meaning of fiqh properly. So that's what we have to understand today, inshallah, and then usul al-fiqh. Fiqh is the Arabic word, you know, which means deep understanding of something. Fiqh means faqoha yafqahu. Fiqh means to have deep understanding of something, proper understanding. You know, sometimes people have superficial understanding. They just look at the surface. So for example, you know, sometimes people see a man or a woman and just see the face, and they make opinion. So that opinion actually is the superficial. But sometimes what happens, you spend many years, many months in the company of someone, and then you understand the person's character, you know, and actually his life proper, much deeply. That actually is the understanding. You know, just seeing the face and appearance and the cloth, and, you know, something like that, that's not the fiqh. Fiqh is to have deep understanding, going beyond the surface. That's what fiqh means. So when we say fiqh, Quran has used the word that why the people don't come from everywhere outside Medina, they come to Medina and then they spend time there, liyatafaqqahu fi ddeen. So they have deep understanding, then they can seek the deep understanding of the deen, religion. Yatafaqqahu, deep understanding of the deen. Certainly, deen does not only mean minor issues, the sunnahs of the wudu, and, you know, and sunnah of the stinja, and, you know, and basic rules of the buying and selling, that not only actually, you know, deen is very comprehensive. That's why, so tafakku, fiqh basically is not only for minor issues, fiqh is for the whole deen. So now we have to understand, you know, fiqh means a deep understanding of the whole deen. So what the whole deen is? Whole deen basically is deen, if we can divide, you know, as it is in the Quran and sunnah properly, so deen can be divided to three parts. How many parts? Three parts. One is usul ad-deen. Usul al-Din. Second is Furu' al-Din al-Kubra. And the third one is Furu' al-Din al-Sughra. Furu' to three things. Usul al-Din, Furu' al-Din al-Kubra. I have written down here. You can see there. Furu' al-Din al-Kubra. And then Furu' al-Din al-Sughra. Usul al-Din means the fundamentals of the religion. Yani for which religion has come. You know, those essential things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you from the religion. So usul al-Din is what? The basics of the deen, fundamentals of the deen, which always have been. You know, nothing to do with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or any prophet. All the prophets, all the messengers, they always have the same. Usul al-Din never change. Usul al-Din, the fundamentals of the religion never change. Whether it's Adam alayhi salam, or Nuh alayhi salam, or Ibrahim alayhi salam, or Musa alayhi salam, or Isa alayhi salam, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, usul al-Din always are same. What usul al-Din is? Usul al-Din is Iman, Islam, submission to Allah. Usul al-Din is Dhikrullah, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Usul al-Din is patience. When the problem comes, you become, you know, have patience. Usul al-Din is Zuhd. Zuhd means when you prefer the hereafter over this world. All the messengers have been teaching the same thing. Every messenger, every prophet, they are usul al-Din. The basic things of the deen. This usul al-Din, you know, that's what we need to actually attain. Everybody has been created to attain, basically, to work hard until they become good, firm in the usul al-Din. That's what we have been created. But usul al-Din cannot be attained by itself. It is not actually something abstract. It only can come through some practices, something you do. So for that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught all the messenger prophet what we call furu' al-Din al-Kubra, the major branches of the religion. That also have been to every prophet, because without them, usul is impossible. Without these major branches, you never can get the basic fundamentals of the religion. So all the prophets and all the messengers, they have been teaching you furu' al-Din al-Kubra, the major branches of the religion. What are major branches? Salah, the prayer. If you want to remember Allah, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want to have submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want to have proper belief in Him, actually it never can be achieved properly without salah. People need to pray. People need to have salah. If people need to have zuhd, you know, preferring the hereafter over this world, and you know, people want to really have their interest always in paradise, all things like that, they need also, besides salah, they need zakah. They need to spend money. They need to learn how to sacrifice. So sacrificing, zakat, sadaqah, tadhiyya, uduhiyya, all those things are what? Major branches of the religion. So usul al-Din and furu' al-Din al-Kubra, they always have been parts of Allah's religion. Nothing to do with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam. Whether the messenger, the Adam alayhi wa sallam, or Nuh alayhi wa sallam, or Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam, or Musa alayhi wa sallam, or anybody, everybody has to have usul al-Din. Everybody has to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everybody has to surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Major branches, same thing. Everybody has to pray. You can see Ibrahim alayhi salam all the time, prayer and zakat. And then Ismail alayhi salam also says that, you know, commands his people, sabr and salah and zakat, all the time. Everybody has same thing. What happens is, these furu' al-Din al-Kubra, major branches, sometimes, you know, people can have problems, people cannot do it properly. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also taught through some messengers, Furu' al-Din al-Kubra, the major minor branches. What minor branches do? Minor branches regulate the major branches. You know, they make it proper. For example, Salah is a major branch. And Salah is, what purpose of Salah is? Dhikr. Like Quran says, Aqimi Salata li Dhikri. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Musa alayhi salam, Aqimi Salata li Dhikri. Establish the prayer, why? For my dhikr. So dhikr is usul al-Din. Fundamentals of religion. And Salah is the major branch which can make you to attain the dhikr. So that's why he said to Musa alayhi salam, Aqimi salata li dhikri. Establish the prayer to remember me. So prayer is from major branches. But major branches, you know, if you can regulate them properly, so they can be much better actually to achieve the right target, right aim. So what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done also, introduce the minor branches. Minor branches what? Like Udu. So if you do Udu and then pray, you can see the difference. If people have no wudu and they pray, and maybe they concentrate whatever they do, but wudu actually makes such a big difference. So wudu is what? Minor branch.
Minor branches, it could be they were not, you know, not all the prophets have got minor branches. You know, minor branches, actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been, you know, making this religion more and more complete. But certainly, Usuluddin and Furu'uddin Kubra, the major branches, they always have been there. And actually, I have collected all the verses of the Quran, but this is not the right time to teach this thing. Just I wanted to give an idea what actually fiqh means. So fiqh is Usuluddin, the fundamentals of the religion, Furu'uddin al-Kubra, the major branches of the religion, and then after that what? Furu'uddin al-Sughra, minor branches of the religion. Now these minor branches of the religion, how do you know them? How do you know Usuluddin? Usuluddin and Furu'uddin al-Kubra, major branches, these two things, Usuluddin and Furu'uddin al-Kubra, they only can be known through the Quran, through revelation simply. Simple thing is, what is Usuluddin and what are the major branches of this religion, they only can be known through the revelation. Simple thing. And they always have been known through the revelation. All the messengers only taught them through the revelation. So in what? Dhikr of Allah is important. Ikhlas, sincerity, Islam, Iman. They are known from where? From revelation. Salah is important, zakah is important, fasting is important. All those things, they are known from where? From the revelation. So Usuluddin and Furu'uddin al-Kubra, major branches, they are only known through the revelation. And revelation that we have got in this religion is the Quran and the Sunnah. So these two things only can be known through the Quran and Sunnah, nothing else really. If Abu Hanifa wants to learn this thing, he had to learn the Quran and Sunnah. If Imam Shafi'i wants to learn this thing, he had to learn them through the Quran and Sunnah. Everybody to knowledge of the Usuluddin and Furu'uddin al-Kubra, the major branches, they depend, you know, on the Quran and the Sunnah. You never can find them anywhere else. Minor branches, they are different types. Minor branches, many of them are in the Quran. Like in wudu, how to do the Quran says, إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ. When you stand for the prayer, then wash your face. So the whole wudu, proper four things are mentioned in the Quran. Tayammum is mentioned in the Quran. So minor branches, many of them are very fine in the Quran. Minor branches, some of them are not the Quran, but they are where? In the Sunnah. Like for example, when you do udu, you are gargling, cleaning your nose, cleaning your teeth. This is not in the Quran, but this is in the Sunnah. In minor branches, something you also can find where? In the Sunnah. In a minor branches, there are something we don't find in the Sunnah, but you find in the agreement or consensus of the Sahaba. Companions of the Prophet ﷺ. That's what ijma means. When ijma will come, I'll explain to you. The consensus of the companions. When the companions agree on something, that then becomes very clear that it's a part of our religion. So there are many things in minor branches which has been known to us through the consensus of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Among the minor branches, there are many of those things which basically, you know, very small details. And they are subject to time. Time changes, details changes. In minor branches, sometimes what is preference? There are two options. You have to choose two options. Which one to prefer in certain conditions? So you need somebody who can judge for you in minor branches. So in minor branches, there are many, many small issues which basically are subject to change of time, subject to change of the space, subject to actually preference, you know, and subject to mistakes. So for example, if you're praying and you forget Fatiha, or you forget Surah, or you did not do tasbih, or instead of one ruku, you did two ruku, you know, instead of two sajda, you did only one sajda, many, many mistakes. So what to do? This is not mentioned in the Quran, this is not in the Sunnah, this is not in the Ijma. Where you learn this? This Qiyas comes. Qiyas basically, the ulama come and they make effort and they, you know, compare from here the Qiyas. You know, this Qiyas is basically where is the effort of the scholars. So like Abu Hanifa, like Malik, like Shafi'i, Ahmad al-Hanbal, Sayyid Musayyab, Alqama, Aswad, you know, hundreds and hundreds of people, they where their effort is the small circle. When Abu Hanifa, rahmullah ta'ala, did ijtihad, he did not ijtihad in Usuluddin. No, that they already established. Imam Abu Hanifa had nothing to do with Usuluddin. When Imam Abu Hanifa did ijtihad, nothing to do with Furu'uddin al-Kubra. When Imam Abu Hanifa did ijtihad, you know, in Furu'uddin al-Sughra, those which are in the Quran, he's not going to tell you, you know, further of the Udu that you already known. You know, Sunnah, you know, things are known in Ijma. Imam Hanifa, the ijtihad just had been in this smallest circle. Smallest circle actually is where the ulama of this ummah will help you. Meaning it, conditions changes, cases changes, time changes, space changes. Sometimes you have two choices, which one to prefer over the other. You know, these minor things, there were need to help of the scholars. Many people think really this is what fiqh is. They don't understand Abu Hanifa and Malik's opinion. They are not substitute to the Quran and Sunnah. Imam Hanifa and Malik and Shafi, they learn Usuluddin, they learn major branches, they learn Marajan branches, they learn Quran and Sunnah. They only made their opinions in those small matters, in the minor branches, where people need their help. Imam Hanifa and Malik and Shafi did not actually teach you about Usuluddin. They did not add Usuluddin. All are from Quran and Sunnah. Imam Hanifa and Malik and Shafi did not teach you about major branches. Imam Hanifa and Malik and Shafi, did not teach you those issues are the minor branches which are in the Quran. They did not teach you those minor issues which are in the Sunnah. They did not teach you those minor issues which are in Imam. They only taught you those minor issues which are basically are in this smallest circle, which where you need to prefer one over the. If you do mistake, the people say, but how Hanafi fiqh is so big? Because mistakes are so big. People keep doing more and more mistakes. Now scholars have to make more and more solution. If you don't concentrate, Sahaba and Tabi'in, when they used to pray, they used to concentrate, no mistake. So they don't need this is more circle. In our time, we pray our mind somewhere else. So we do actually more and more mistakes. So when you do a new mistake, then you go to Abu Hanifa or Malik or Shafi scholar, ask him solution. So they write in the fiqh, if somebody does this mistake, this solution, you do this mistake, this solution, if the time happened, this. So that way, this circle kept growing. This circle basically growing because mistakes are growing. This circle also grows because the cases of the people are growing, new cases, new changes. But otherwise, this is not the real reason. That why in this small circle, it doesn't really matter who you follow, Abu Hanifa or Malik or Shafi, because it is so small, so minor. Real thing actually is around that. If you follow Abu Hanifa and you get Usuluddin correct, fine. If you follow Imam Shafi and you get Dhikr of Allah correct, that's fine. If you follow Imam Malik and you get khushu in the prayer, fine. It doesn't really matter who you follow in this circle. What really matters is the real thing. Real things are Usuluddin. To understand, people think fiqh basically is what Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi have actually explained, and that is fiqh. So they think their thinking and their explanation is substitute to whole religion. No. Their contribution in this religion is very, very minor. That basically just this smallest circle. And this smallest circle is not only Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi. This is shared by the ulama of this ummah until the qiyamah. So in this smallest circle, Abu Hanifa made a contribution. Actually, not only Abu Hanifa. Many Sahaba made a contribution. Tabi'in made a contribution. If you learn in Hanafi madhab, Al-Qama Naswad made a contribution. After Al-Qama Naswad, Ibrahim Nakhai made a contribution. After Ibrahim Nakhai, Hammad ibn Sulaiman made a contribution. Then Abu Hanifa took all that and he added some new thing for his own time. Abu Hanifa actually, I wrote a book, Al-Fiqh al-Islami on Hanafi madhab. In the fiqh of the Salah, Imam Abu Hanifa actually has everything he takes either from Quran or from Sunnah or from Abdullah al-Masud or from Al-Qama, Aswad, Ibrahim Nakhai, Hamad ibn Sulaiman. There are only very, very few things where Abu Hanifa has his own contribution. You can see. So when you say Hanafi madhab, it basically are all those things and plus a little bit of Abu Hanifa. Then after Abu Hanifa, his students Abu Yusuf Muhammad also made some contribution. Then after Abu Yusuf Muhammad, few other Hanafis made contribution. Then major works like Bada'u Sanaya, this thing and that book. Until after. Every time people keep making a little bit more contribution. That what basically is ulama. Ulama's contribution all is actually just in this small circle. This small circle is not important. Understand it properly. It really doesn't matter even if you do mistake. If this small circle is so unimportant that the Prophet says that whenever it is hadith in Sunan, and many people say it is Sahih, and some people say Hasan. The Prophet said actually, and part of the hadith actually in Sahih Bukhari, so the Prophet said when somebody makes ijtihad, means make effort to find a ruling for Muslims in this small circle, what the Prophet said, if he is right, he'll get double reward. If he is wrong, what he will do? He will get one reward. This smallest circle is so unimportant that even if you do mistake, you get one reward. But in the Usuluddin, if you do mistake, are you going to get a reward? It becomes kufr and shirk. Usuluddin are not like, you do mistake, you get reward. In Usuluddin, if you do mistake, you become kufr, it can become shirk, it can become bid'ah. There is no reward in this thing. Usuluddin has mistake in Usuluddin, never any reward. If people do mistake in the major branch, there is no reward. For example, people instead of praying five times, they pray only three times. Or people instead of praying four rakah of the zuhr, they pray three rakah or two rakah. They don't have reward. Actually, they will get sin. In Usuluddin al-Furuddin al-Kubra, even actually Furuddin al-Sughra, which in the Quran is Sunnah, if people do mistake, there is no reward. They are actually sin. But this small circle, it's unimportant. It has no significance. It basically is only ulama's, I will tell you exactly what means ulama's judgment. A alif's judgment in certain condition, what you do. That judgment is actually purely mind of alim, who has this knowledge. That judgment very often, more likely be correct, but sometimes I can have mistake. If they are right and they make effort, they get double reward. And if they have mistake, they have got one reward. When we use the word fiqh, it means all that. Try to understand. Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi's contribution is very, very small in this whole thing. Unfortunately, when people say fiqh, they only know this thing. They have no idea of this thing. It really doesn't matter in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you follow every details of Abu Hanifa's ijtihad, but you don't get usul. No importance. Means you pray and don't remember Allah. Your mind not to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You pray no khushu. You earn money and you follow Islamic finance, but no zuhd. You love this dunya and you follow Islamic finance. But if people make Islamic banking to become rich and rich and to spare the poor people and they don't prefer hereafter, it is nothing to do with Allah's religion. Though you follow Abu Hanifa in word by word, letter by letter, this is not fiqh. Fiqh is that you start from here, Usuluddin. Usuluddin, then major branches, then minor branches, then those which are minor branches in the Quran, then which are Sunnah, then those which are Ijma, then those the small one also, which in the Qiyas. In this small one, don't worry too much. If you are right, it's fine. If you are mistaken, still you are covered, surrounded by so many good things. Because it is a circle. You can't exceed the limit anyway. Within this small circle, mistakes of being right doesn't matter really. It's more intention. Is it clear? So when we say fiqh, that's why somebody asks Hassan Basri, who's faqih? He says, what faqih means? Faqih means al-zahidu fi dunya, al-raghibu fi al-akhirah. Faqih is the man who has zuhd in this dunya. Means he does not, he's not interested in dunya. He's interested in akhirah. That's what faqih means. Faqih means usuluddin. Faqih means the one who has Allah's name, dhikrullah, the one who has khushu, the one who has humility. The one actually who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Faqih is the one who remembers paradise and fire of hell. Faqih are the people who have patience and the sabr in this life. That's what fiqh means. So try to understand. So when we say fiqh, that's what means. Fiqh basically means all usuluddin, all major branches, all minor branches, and all those issues of minor branches in the Quran, which are in the Sunnah, which are in the Quran, and also fiqh kind of mean is more, this small circle where the ulama have to make their contribution. Means judgment of the ulama, judgment of the human judgment basically. This small circle is human judgment. The human judgment also can come in those cases where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not put the details, he left to the people because they are minor issues, very, very small issues, mistakes in them doesn't matter much really. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left to the people. That is, human judgment, subject to the human judgment. In this one, you have to make effort to be right, but if you do mistake, it doesn't really matter. Actually, what matters is all those things. So that's what we say, fiqh. Now we're coming what usul al-fiqh means. So usul al-fiqh basically means to learn those rules which can help you to derive all those things from the sources. So usul al-fiqh means to learn those rules which can help you to understand what usul din are. Usul al-fiqh means to learn those rules which can help you to know what are major branches. Usul al-fiqh are to understand you what are the minor branches. Usul al-fiqh actually is to understand what minor branch details are in the Quran, what are in the Sunnah, what are in the Ijma, and what are in the Qiyas, and how to do Qiyas. That usul al-fiqh means. Usul al-fiqh basically are the rules how to understand the text basically, how to understand the Quran Sunnah. Usul al-fiqh does for this religion, same thing what the grammar does for the language. Or what the logic does for philosophy. If you learn philosophy, so before philosophy, you need to learn logic. So logic basically are those rules which regulate your thinking. The rules for the thing. Logic means rules of thinking. How you think. And philosophy is what? Thinking. So philosophy is your thinking and logic are rules of thinking. Language is your expression And what is the grammar? Grammar is rules of that expression, how to speak the language. Now, coming really about the usul, one major mistake actually happened in this religion is that people did not understand the relation between fiqh and usul al-fiqh properly. One major mistake happened. And to make it clear what the problem happened with the people is, just take the example of the language. You know, language basically is based on the grammar. If there's no grammar, there's no language. If you just learn words, but don't learn the grammar, how to put them together, can you express? No expression. If you just learn, you know, like in Arabic language, you learn like, you know, طَاوِلَةٌ بَيْتٌ أَرْضٌ سَمَاءٌ, something like that, can you speak? You have to know the grammar, how to put them together. So for example, you learn qala means said, and Allah means Allah. So if you don't know the grammar, you know, these words actually don't make a language. You have to learn the grammar. Grammar is that, you know, if you want to say Allah said, so you have to bring the fa'il before the ism, before the fa'il, so you have to say qala Allahu. So once you know the grammar, then language works. Language never can work without grammar. Language actually based on the grammar. So understand, without the grammar, language will not work. But tell me really, when you learn the grammar, what happens? Do you copy? For example, when you are born, you learn many sentences from your mother. Then after that, you study in the school, you learn the grammar, you learn language, many things really. Then after that, in your real life, when you express yourself, what you do? Have you memorized all sentences that you learn from your mother, and then you say them exactly as they are? No. What actually happened? What happened actually is you learn the words, you learn the grammar in your mind properly, and you know now it is flexible. I do not necessarily need to say same sentence. So my mother used to say that I love biryani, she said. So I don't need to say same words. But I, for example, I love, you know, kebab. So I can say I love kebab. I don't need to say I love biryani. No, it's not. You have to say I love kebab. You learn the grammar from your mother and vocabulary, but you don't need to repeat the same thing. So try to understand, language basically that you learn without grammar, language never can work. But when you learn the grammar, you don't copy someone. Now you are flexible, you can make your own sentence. When you make your own sentence, tell me what you do. You have got a meaning in your mind which you want to express. There is a meaning, actually let me lie down here, maybe it can help. Actually, more than that, if you want deeper, things like that, really. That how the language works. Can you see that? Is it clear now? Okay, how the language works, really. Language works, you know, you have got a haqiqa, a reality. That reality, you know, needs to, you know, conveyed in a meaning. Meanings basically are just in your mind. Because when you see a reality, a meaning comes to your mind. Anything, for example, you see a person and it comes to your mind that you love. So loving is a meaning. And when you start the person, so this meaning, you want to express it. When you express it, what happens is you find the right words. Then you put those right words in the right grammar. Right grammar, that's what you do. So in any language, what you do really, first thing in your mind comes, what is the reality that I want to, you know, I want to conceive? So first thing is any reality that you conceive, basically you take in your mind. So haqiqa, then what you take in your mind, the concept in your mind. Then this concept you want to put the cloth of the, basically you want to express that in the words. But the words don't express unless you have put them right construction. You know, follow the rule properly. That's what you need really. If you don't have haqiqa in your mind, meaning never can come. And if you have no meaning in your mind, then basically words will not help. If you have no meaning and just say words, tell me what will happen. People say you are mad. In like that, you just somebody said anything like, you said the wall has eaten the food. Tell me. Does that mean? Because I don't have a concept properly what happened. I have no situation in my mind. No concept in my mind. Don't know reality. No concept. I just use some word and grammar. Grammar and the word don't make language. Try to understand. Though actually many people will think if you have got word and grammar properly, it becomes language. Does it become language? Tell me in this sentence what is wrong. If I say, akal al-jidaru at-ta'ama, the whole ate food. Is there anything wrong? Akala is a word from Arabic language. Jidar also word from Arabic language. And Atam is a word from Arabic language. So I've taken words from Arabic language. And I put the sentence correctly as Arab people use. Akala is fa'il. And al-jidar is fa'il. To marfu akala al-jidaru. And Atam is maful behi. To mansub akala al-jidaru ta'ama. I followed the vocabulary. And I followed the grammar. What is mistake here? Mistake is because it is not really enough. Real thing is first get haqiq, what you are observing, and then get that meaning correct in your mind, then express them. Without haqiqa and ma'na, words and words and grammar don't make language. Think properly. It never happened. Nobody does like that. People don't do this thing. So tell me, when your mother spoke a sentence, what she does? She had haqiqa, reality. Then she conceived that reality in her mind. Then she find right words and right grammar to express them. Now when you use language, when you express something, what you need? You need your own haqiqa. You need your own meaning. Then you choose right grammar. It is not that your mother thinks and you express. Is it possible? Tell me that you think right. I'm son of my mother. I love her so much. So she thinks for me and I just use the same words. Tell me, is it how the language works? If your mother say I love, what it means? That she loves. When you say I love, it does not mean my mother love. Does it mean like that? That you say I love, and you ask who you love. Say, no, my mother used to say I love, so I just repeat the sentence. No, she used to say love because she used to love. So she has a meaning in mind. Do you have any meaning? No, I just copy my mother. Tell me, is it language? You learn the words and grammar, but you learn actually connection. You have to learn the reality. Is it clear? Language basically, expression is based on thinking. You basically have haqiqa reality. And you get the meaning, reality in your meaning, in mind. Then you express in the words, a proper sentence, that's what language means. That what really fiqh means. Fiqh does not mean that Abu Hanifa comes and thinks. And then you do something, I ask why you do? Because I'm Hanafi. Abu Hanifa used to do the same thing, so I don't see the same thing. Is it really fiqh? Is it understanding, thinking? If language cannot work like that, can fiqh work like that? That's what most Muslims do really. Most Muslims, they put on a topi in the prayer. Why you put? Because my father, when he used to pray in the mosque of my village, he used to put on hat. So I do the same thing. Tell me really, is it religion? Is it what religion means? That you saw your father putting a hat on on his head when he's praying, and now you put a hat on your head, and you become religious? That what religion means? Get reality properly. Try to understand really what you want to do. You want to please your Lord. You want to remember, you want to do Usuluddin. You want to fear your Lord. You want to love him. Then think really, when I love my Lord, when I remember him, what is the best thing to do? The Salah. When I do Salah, then how? What are the details of the Salah? Where I learn? From the Quran and Sunnah. Then I have to learn from the Quran and Sunnah. And when I learn Salah, then also there are minor details. Wudu and this and that, ghusl and tahara and purification, killing the clothes and this and that. Where I learn that from? You learn from Quran, Sunnah, from Ijma. And then also you learn from the opinions of the ulama in those details which you don't have. Then after that, you do this thing, keeping in mind the reality. So reality basically is that you want to please your Lord. This is a reality. So basically, meaning when I'm praying 4 rak'ah prayer, what purpose is? I want to remember my Lord. I want to please him. So that is that what, like for example, when I say to someone, I love you. Tell me why I'm saying this sentence. To convey to him, this my what my feelings are. I want to convey him. So that's why I'm saying I love you. When I pray, think really, why I'm doing this prayer? I want to please my Lord. So that should be clear. If that is not there, then basically it is same thing. Like, you say, I love someone, and you ask him what he means. He said, Ajaj, just repeat the center of my mother. To tell me, repeating the center of, if you say to someone, I love you, and the person asks you why you said this, you say, because my mother used to say to her, her neighbor, I love you, so I just repeat. To tell me, are the person going to be impressed by you? Tell me, if you say Allahu Akbar, and stand in the mosque, and you don't have any idea of dhikrullah, no idea of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why you do? Because your father used to do. Tell me, is going to be pleasing your Lord? Without the meaning, language never works. Without the usuluddin, furu'ud-dil kubra, religion never, deen never works. If you do udu, and you have no idea of prayer, if you have no idea of pleasing your Lord, usuluddin, wudu has no meaning. This wudu that you wash your face and all those things, and believers can do as well. Ghusl that you do, unbelievers also can do. Islamic finance that Muslims do, unbelievers also can do. What it means, Islamic is that you connect it with Usuluddin, that you are doing this because you want to please your Lord. If Usuluddin are not there, minor details, there is no difference between minor details between a believer or an unbeliever. To try to understand this matter properly, without that, you know, things don't work. So Usul al-Fiqh basically is like the grammar. In the grammar, you need the rules. Without the rules, language don't work. But language depends also on the meaning and on the reality. If you don't have the reality and the meaning, your mind, basically, the fiqh will not work. Fiqh will never work. Is it clear? That why, you know, if you worship your Lord and your mind is not there, it's not prayer. It's not worshipping. You know, it's not there. Many, many people actually have taken away all those real meanings of the fiqh and they just consider and they smoke like Jews. That was Jewish religion is to get the details right. That's all. It doesn't really matter what your intention are, what you think. It is not. What matters are the laws. Details of the laws must be correct. That's what they think. And Christian people have dropped all the laws and every details anyway. Just have some concept in mind, nothing else. This religion not like that. Religion actually combination all things. You have to have usul. You have to have details. You have to follow. If I have all those things, but you have to connect them like language. Can you think like a language, just meaning? No words? There are Christian people want to say to you. They want to say religion means love. But how love you? If you love your Lord, you don't worship him, don't have prayer, don't sacrifice, nothing else. What this love means? Can you imagine language just meaning? Tell me. Is it possible? Language means all that. So either Jews are not right. If somebody said language means words, are they right? If somebody said language means words and the rules, are they right? No. That what Jewish people are telling people. That you just follow the laws blindly and proper details, doesn't matter. Not really. Language is all those four things. Religion really is all four things. Without that, this deen doesn't work. Tafaqquh fi deen is all those things. Try to understand. You learn from Abu Hanifa rahmullah ta'ala the rules of thinking. But then you think for yourself. Then when you pray, you are praying for your prayer. Not you are praying Abu Hanifa's prayer. When Abu Bakr Siddiq and Umar Farooq, they learned the prayer from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in full details. So are they copying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or they making their own prayer? They making all their own prayer. When the Prophet say Allahu Akbar, do they say Allahu Akbar at the same time? No. Little bit, you know, before, little bit, you know, with him, somebody, little bit after him, everybody has their own intention. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reads, you know, tasbih, do they actually start with the same time and end at the same time? No. Everybody does according to their own ability, according to their own understanding. You learn from him, then you make it your own thing. Then you make your, like, you know, I learn from my teacher's language, all the words and grammar. When I use, I don't copy him. Then I use, you know, I make it my own language. When you learn the fiqh from Abu Hanifa, so you don't copy Abu Hanifa. You make your own fiqh. Then now you actually, you know, make your own judgment what to do. You learn from him, he has a big teacher, you learn from his rule, like you learn Arabic grammar from me, for example, if you learn from me, you are not going to repeat the same sentence which I say. You know, people have to understand properly. Is it clear? But if you have a question later, you can ask. Now, next thing really is, which I want to tell, what really contribution of Abu Hanifa and Malik al-Shafi is, that called ijtihad. Ijtihad basically means making full effort to understand the condition that you are facing, the case that you are facing, and to understand in this case what is Allah's command. To understand this thing. Relation between the command and between the case. Between your condition and between Allah's command. You want to create a relation that you want to. In this condition, what Allah wants from me. You know, for example, I'm traveling, and now I am traveling, I don't have enough time. And only time I've got released at 2 o'clock, you know, and if I pray Zuhr, I don't know if I can stop for Asr. So what should I do? Now Allah's command to pray. And my condition is I don't have time. I only have got time, actually very little time. What should I do? I have to make judgment. This judgment is my judgment. I can learn from the people how to make judgment, but in every condition I have to make judgment. Imam Hanifa rahmatullah, what he does really in those minor details where Allah's commands does not say specifically in this condition what you do, he makes judgment. He makes judgment. This effort to make judgment is called ijtihad. What ijtihad is? Ijtihad is to spend the full effort to make your judgment in any circumstances. So for ijtihad, what you need to know? You need to know the commands of Allah, and you need to know your condition properly. Then you can make judgment. Basically, ijtihad means to spend the full effort. Ijtihad means to make full effort. Ijtihad means to spend full effort to make your judgment in any condition of your life. But when you make your judgment, you need to know command of Allah, sources, and you need to know your condition. If people don't know their condition, they will fail. This is what happened. For example, if I give fatwa about banking, and I don't know what banking means, tell me, even if I am the biggest faqih of the time, can I give right fatwa? Before giving fatwa, I need to know what banking means. What bank means. And if I know banking, but I don't know the Quran Sunnah, tell me, can I be faqih? Can I give fatwa? I need to know both of them. Once I learn both of them, then I have to make effort to make a right command, right judgment on the right time. That judgment, making effort to get the judgment as right as possible in any given condition, that was called ijtihad. That ijtihad, the full ijtihad, no doubts are telling, people have to have so much knowledge, but that ijtihad is required from every single believer. Every single believer, in every single condition of their life, they need to make a full ijtihad to make judgment what I should now. If you don't do this really, you are not following Allah's command. You have to make effort. You learn from Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi, but in every, like a language, in every, whenever a new meaning comes to your mind, you want to express really, who is going to make judgment for you? Which sentence to use? Which words to use? What expression will be? Who is going to judge for you? You or somebody else? You judge. Whenever you express really, who judge for you? You judge. But this judgment, in this judgment, not everybody is equal. Some people are more learned, some people are less learned. Those who are less learned, they get knowledge from the people who are more learned. You learn from Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi, but in every time when you speak, you make your own judgment. Every time when you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to make your own judgment. Make effort. If you don't make effort, you are not obeying him. When you make effort, even if you do mistake, he loves that. That no, my slave made effort. My slave really made effort to obey me. He did a mistake. I forgive him. As in the language, every single individual, in every single time in their life, they need to make effort, their own judgment, effort to their own judgment to speak. In this religion, every believer, in every condition of their life, they need to make their own judgment how to obey their Lord. That's what they need. If they don't do, and they just basically make religion like a topi, put on and just take it off, it's not religion. It should be deep in your heart, really. You should understand what you're doing. Is it clear? So basically, meaning is, the ijtihad is to make as the best effort as possible to make your judgment in any given condition, in any condition that you're facing. That ijtihad can vary. Some people actually have, like language. Some people can write so nicely. Some people cannot write so nicely. Some people can speak so nicely. Some people can only learn from those people. It's ijtihad varies. But still, every speaker does ijtihad. Every speaker makes effort. Every speaker, he makes his own judgment. Similarly, every believer must make his own effort to follow this religion. When they don't make effort and they just do casually, it becomes culture. Religion, what? Because a culture. So when people think really, in this condition, you need to wear poti, topi. And in this condition, you need to say assalamu alaikum. In this condition, you need to say alhamdulillah. In this condition, you need to say barakallah. In this, you need to say subhanallah. But you really not make effort. Why I say subhanallah? What actually purpose is there? It's not religion, it's culture. What is it? It's a culture. Culture basically, no thinking, no understanding, no expression, no effort. Culture basically is what? Copying. Culture means to copy certain people. Language and religion, none of them are copying. You cannot speak on your behalf by copying. You cannot copy your mom's sentence. You cannot copy your teacher's sentence. Similarly, left of I'm teaching you. If you record all my teaching and then you memorize them, can you teach Usul al-Fiqh? No. You need to learn it, then you have to make it your own effort, your own thinking, your own expression. That's what you need to do. When people copy, it becomes culture, which has no life, just dead, basically. Dead thing. Religion is not a culture. Is it clear? That what many people actually made in fiqh, just a culture. So, if you do certain things, you become Hanafi, certain things you become Maliki, certain things you become Shafi. Real religion has gone. Is it clear? So let me summarize to you. When we say fiqh, we don't only mean fiqh of the minor details. We mean by fiqh Firstly, and more importantly, the Usuluddin, the fundamentals of the religion. Then after that, the major branches. Then after that, minor branches, those which are in the Quran, then those which are in Sunnah, then those which are in Ijma, and those also which are known through the efforts of the mujtahideen. That's what we learn. That's what fiqh means. And I mentioned, you know, usul means those rules which can help you to derive the fiqh from the source. Usul does for the fiqh same thing as the grammar does for the language. But I mentioned to you, as grammar and the words cannot make language. What you need to know what you are going to say. You need to have some meaning. Just the words and grammar don't make language. So similarly, usul al-fiqh does not make fiqh. Because what actually people need really, they need to think really. What they want to achieve? What do you want to do? When you're praying, what purpose is? You have to connect that. If you just keep copying it, that becomes a culture. That's not religion. So that actually is it. So fiqh is fiqh of the whole deen. And then, usul is the rules to understand them. And then I mentioned to you that every believer needs in this life, in every single condition, to make their own judgment. So to make best effort, to make your own judgment, that's called ijtihad. In every condition. For example, your father asks you to do something. And that is time when you have to attend a class. Now you have to make a judgment whether you have to listen to your father and whether you have to attend the class or whether you have to make compromise, whether you have to convince your father that, you know, let me go to class and then I come back and then I'll do what you want. You have got many, many choices, 3 to 4 choices. To make a judgment in that condition, that's called ijtihad. That's called what? Ijtihad. Ijtihad is not obligatory only on Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi. Ijtihad is obligatory on every single believer according to their ability. Without learning how to make your own judgment, you cannot be a good believer. You need to make your judgment. But sometimes, in order to make your own judgment, you need to seek help. Like, for example, sometimes I want to express something in English language. I am making effort, but I cannot get right sentence. Then I can ask someone who can help me, 2-3 people, and then I make judgment. That's fine, but I made my effort. To every judgment, you need to make effort. But when you cannot make on your own, you can ask help. You can seek help from the people. There's no harm in that. You can seek help from Abu Hanifa, from Malik, from Shafi, from Hanbal, from your imam, from your teacher. You can ask them to help you. But you need to make your own judgment. That judgment is called ijtihad. That ijtihad is obligatory on every believer. As it is obligatory on every speaker to make effort to understand what is the meaning he wants to convey, what the message, and how to convey that message. Every speaker, at every time, they think, they make judgment. Similarly, every believer needs to make their own judgment when they want to obey their Lord. Is it clear to everybody? So now you understand the meaning of the fiqh properly, you know the meaning of the usul fiqh, you know the meaning of ijtihad, and you also have learnt the contribution of the ulama. Now you know contribution of the ulama is so small. Now you don't fight. You are not going to fight whether I'm Hanafi or Malik or Shafi or Hanbali. It really doesn't matter. Even if somebody does mistake in that, still they get reward. As long as you really make your effort to obey your Lord, you know, these things are right, then in this circle, small circle, mistakes of being right or wrong, it really has no importance. If you are sincere, you are right, get double reward. If you are not, do mistake, still get reward. There's no sin in this one anyway. In this circle, there's no sin. Sins only come in the other circles. And for this small circle, with so much fighting. So much fight, unnecessarily, I'm Hanafi, so I'm Maliki. And not only that, I cannot pray in this masjid because this Maliki masjid, you know, I'm Hanafi, how can I pray behind Maliki imam? Unnecessary problem. You know, real religion is same thing. To please your Lord. That's what real is. So that's what people need to understand. You need to know the fiqh. You need to know usul fiqh. And you need to know ijtihad. All three are very, very important. Without that, really, nobody can be a good believer. So now after teaching that, so let's come, inshallah, to start the book. It will be helpful. Now it will be easier for you to understand. So as you know, this book actually is written just an introduction for the usul fiqh. In usul fiqh, most things actually are same in all the madhahib, but in later people, you know, because the differences become, you know, growing and growing. So you can see that when the people start compiling their own works, Hanafi, Malik, and Shafi, differences arrive. But the differences actually are not so important, as you can see. So in this book, when we're teaching, it is basically our teaching all the categorization according to Hanafi madhab. But it does not mean those details are only in Hanafi madhab. Many details are same everybody. The way the details categories are and the way they put in right in certain order, it is actually based on Hanafi books of the Usul al-Fiqh, because most people are Hanafi. So now see fiqh. Al-Fiqh, ta'alif al-Fiqh, wa huwa fi istilah al-ulama al-ilmu bil ahkam al-shar'iyya al-amaliyya al-muktasaba min adillatiha al-tafsiliyya kama yutlaqu ala majmu'ati ahdi al-ahkam. So according to the ulama, you know, if you know which page is on the page number 8. So what fiqh means? Fiqh basically means maybe you can see here. Get the copy, you know, so that it's easy for everybody. I don't know if it's coming or not. So fiqh is what? Fiqh is knowing the ahkam. And ahkam will come later on anyway, inshallah. Because soon the ahkam will come. So fiqh means, or you can say, if you want to translate ahkam in modern language, you can say ahkam, fiqh means, you know, deep understanding of the priorities. What are priorities of your life in every day? Priorities. What you have to do first, what you do secondary, or the knowing the real priorities of your life, how they are derived from the Quran Sunnah. So, al-muqtasaba min adillatiha tafsiliyya. So, for example, that you learn that in wudu, how many fard are there? Four. Four fard are there in Hanafi madhab. Why? Because the Quran says, "Daqumtum ila salati faghsilu wujuhakum." So, that is called the fiqh. Because you learn that in Urdu, you have to do these four things. And you also learn that why we do these four things? Because they are in the Quran. So knowing of those both, they're called fiqh. Tell me, in our time, what people do? People only know rules, and they say they know fiqh. Fiqh is not knowing the rules. Fiqh is knowing the rules, how they are derived from the sources. Means connection between sources and rules both. They're fiqh. For example, many ignorant people, you know, they're not actually learned. Maybe they do wudu properly. Is it fiqh? No. Fiqh only becomes when they know they are doing these four things because these four are mentioned in the Quran. They're doing these few things because they're mentioned in the Sunnah. So when you connect the rulings with the sources, that is called fiqh. So fiqh basically is knowing of those rules which are derived from the detailed sources properly. Is it clear? And usul al-fiqh is, next thing, usul al-fiqh is knowledge of those rules which help you how to derive the ahkam from the sources. That usul al-fiqh means. Like, grammar, to language actually is expression. And grammar is what? Grammar is those rules which help you how to put the words in a certain order which can help you to convey the message. That's rule, that's grammar. Same like logic. What logic does for philosophy? And what the grammar does for the language, same thing usul al-fiqh does for the fiqh. So learning, knowing of those rules which can help you how to derive the rulings from the sources. Is it clear? And certainly most of these rules, they are rules of the language. Because Quran Sunnah is language, Hadith are language. So basically how to understand a text, that was usul al-fiqh. Usul al-fiqh, most part of that usul al-fiqh is how to understand a text, try to understand. So it is not actually something just Islam. In any culture, when people make effort to understand a text, they follow certain procedure. That procedure actually called usul al-fiqh. That's what usul al-fiqh is. So usul al-fiqh basically is to learn those rules which can help you to understand a text. So when the Quran says "Idha qumtum ila salati faghsilu wujuhakum," what this text means? So what can help me to understand what it means? That actually usul al-fiqh is. So usul al-fiqh is learning of those rules which can help you how to derive the ahkam from the sources. And as I mentioned, most part of the usul is language basically. Not everything, because there's something will come also in what hukm is this. But major real parts, they are language. They are connected to religion, language, how to understand any text. Those usul you can apply to any text. That actually when you learn usul al-fiqh, you become clever. Then when you read any text, you know how to get the meaning. Because that usul al-fiqh, usul al-fiqh actually helps you to how to understand a text. So you read, for example, a poetry or anything like that, or any text, So you know really how the meaning, how it works to get the meaning. So most part of Usul al-Fiqh is, you know, those rules which are based on the language, that how to derive, you know, how to understand a text, simple thing. So in the Usul al-Fiqh, you know, what we discuss. Okay, that will come later anyway. So you can see in the fiqh with this, you know, you basically discuss the ahkam and Usul al-Fiqh, the rules. And then after that, you know, I discuss in this book that how the fiqh came into existence. So, you know, certainly fiqh came to exist from the beginning. Like, you know, when the prayer is there, fasting, the zakat, and hajj, the fiqh will be there anyway. The fiqh always have been there. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all those people. And development of the fiqh came, you know, like you can see, you know, something in the Quran, something in the Sunnah, something in the Ijma, something in the Qiyas. So that how the fiqh kept developing until our time. It keeps all the time developing and more literature keep coming. That how happened. In Hanafi madhab, you know, if when people discuss the major jurists in Hanafi madhab, so that I'll tell you because the book is based on that. But certainly, no doubt, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was himself faqih. And then after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, among his sahaba, they, you know, there are many people who used to give fatwa and they were fuqaha. Ibn Hazm al-Ghahiri had mentioned 120 of them. How many? 120 people, male and female, among sahaba, who used to teach fiqh and used to give fatwa. And roughly, many people agree they are around that number. And these two people, you know, they used to give fatwa in Medina. Many of them moved to Makkah al-Mukarrama, and many of them moved to different cities of Islam. When Umar Khattab became Khalifa, then he appointed certain great companions of the fiqh in certain cities to teach the people there. So like for example, Abu Darda, who was appointed in Syria. You know, the people, different cities. So one of the major companions in Medina was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who died in the year 32 of Hijrah. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he is one of the very early people to become Muslim. You know, according to some narrations, he is the sixth person to become Muslim, sixth. Before him, only five people were Muslim, and he's the sixth one to become Muslim. You know, great mind, good thinking, piety, and always keen to learn. And, you know, he was so keen to learn, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always really appreciated him and respected him in that manner. So he was allowed to come to a Prophet's house anytime. For anybody else to take permission, for Abu Abdullah al-Masud, it was not him to take permission. That way, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, when he came to Medina at the time of the conquest of Khaybar, you know, Khaybar was conquered when, you know, in the Hijrah year around 7. So that is the time when Khaybar was conquered. In that time, when Abu Musa Shahid came to Medina, so he said, I used to think in the beginning that Abdullah al-Mas'ud is the part of the family of the Prophet. Because he's so much in the house all the time there with the Prophet, so I was thinking he must be from the family in the beginning. You can imagine really how he close was to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to actually go with him, you know, when the Prophet used to go for human need, you know, all the time he learned from him so much. When Abu Bakr Siddiq became Khalifa, you know, he's still teaching in Makkah al-Madina, and when Umar became Khalifa, Umar actually depends on Abdullah Masud very heavily. He always seeks his help, you know, learn knowledge and all those things. Then Abdullah, when Umar the Latran, his time, when Iraq and Syria all that happened, and he established some new cities. Among the new cities that he established are two major cities in Iraq, Kufa and Basra. And Kufa actually became a center of in all major Arab tribes. So many Arab tribes, they went and settled there, and also the conquerors, they settled there. It became good, you know, big city. And the people of Kufa, they wanted somebody who can come and teach them. So then Umar Khattab al-Latran chose Abdullah al-Masud. And he wrote a letter to people of Kufa that I'm sending to you Abdullah Masud to teach. And then he wrote in the letter also a sentence, Aathartukum bi Abdullahi ala nafsi. Aathartukum bi Abdullahi ala nafsi. I prefer Abdullah Masud, you know, over myself. Do I need him Medina? But your need to me is much more important. So I'm sending you him to Kufa. So Abdullah Masud Allah came to Kufa and he taught people, you know, the fiqh. To that, inshallah, the history I will explain in the next session. And before that, if you have any question, please ask. There are questions there, yeah.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. You wrote some words in red on the diagram. And the first word I think was al-haqiqa, but I don't know what the other words were.
Al-ma'na.
Pardon?
Al-ma'na.
Ma'na.
Ma'na, al-ma'na. You know what meaning means?
Meaning.
Meaning basically is internal, basically perception, you can say. Internal perception of a reality. So reality is there. You know, for example, when you think about moon, so this moon in your mind is a meaning, but moon outside is a reality. So reality is always external. Then you make this reality internalized in your mind. That's called meaning. So you have haqiqa. Haqiqa is external facts, external realities. That haqiqa. And meaning is internal perception of that reality. And what is language is? Language is then translate that internal reality into language, basically into words. And words depend on the proper construction, means grammar. That's what you need. So people basically always have four things that I mentioned to you. Haqiqa, the reality, meaning, then you have got the words, and then you have got the grammar. If four things are there, then you express yourself. If any of them is missing, you cannot express. If haqiqa is not there, you cannot express yourself. If meaning is not there, you cannot express yourself. The four things are, all four are needed.
And my question in relation to that was purely just about the what those Arabic letters are. I understood the first one, and you've explained the second one. So the third word and the fourth word, what are they?
The words.
Yes, the words themselves.
Al-haqiqa, al-ma'na, al-lafz,
and then
al-nahw, al-qawa'id, you can say al-qawa'id, al-nahw. Al-qawa'id, rules, grammars.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
But you can read al-qawa'id.
Thank you.
Can you see?
Yes, thank you.
Is it clear?
Yeah.
You know, as in the language, anything is missing. Can you make a language? No, I gave you an example. If I said to you, أَكَلَ الْجِدَارُ وَالطَّعَامَ. Words are there. Arabic words, and also Arabic grammar. Akala is fa'il, jidar is fa'il, and ta'am is maful bihi. And jidar is fa'il to marfu, and ta'am is maful bihi to mansub. To all proper. But what is missing there? Missing there is no meaning. There is no meaning there. It's not reality. Words don't eat food. So it is not language. You know, it is just basically, it's madness. Similarly, in the religion, you need all these four things. People need this thing. People need really, when you pray, you need really know what you're going to do. What's the purpose of your prayer? You need that in your mind. So basically, religion is same, or can you say fiqh? Fiqh is same thing as expression. Yeah. Any other question?
Yes. Sorry. Sorry.
You know, this thing, if you understand how language works, it really will be always helpful to you to understand how the religion works. How the religion, you will be understand properly. You will never miss. And then you want to also understand how to forgive the mistakes. Because, when people express themselves, some people are not very good in language. But when you see that, they made effort to convey the message, you become happy. Oh, no, don't worry. Mistake, everybody does. You accept that. Same as your Lord. When you worship him and you really make effort, but you do some minor mistakes in details, he said, don't worry. You did your best. That's fine. I'll accept it. So in the language, people accept wrong sentences. Similarly, in the ibadah, Allah can accept mistakes. But what should be the main thing is, meaning should be there. If sentence has no meaning, then nobody is going to accept. But if you have meaning properly, convey the meaning properly, and you have some mistakes in the words, you did not choose the right word, or did not have right grammar, people can forgive you. If you worship your Lord, and you have a suluddin in mind, and a major branch of all the mind, then you have some minor details, wrong, your Lord will forgive you. That keep in mind. It basically, religion is very, very much similar to the language. In the language, what people look more important, but now what happened in our time, what more important actually is that these minor details should be more right. It is Jewish way. That's not religion. Yeah. Is there any other question?
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. I wanted to ask about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu anhu. Were you saying that he was kind of like a pioneer in fiqh? Like, was he one of the first kind of top in the like in terms of teaching fiqh and explaining what it is?
Yeah, you know, Abdullah Masood is among the top fuqaha of this ummah anyway. After the Khulafa Rashidun, he is the best person, Abdullah Masood, Zaid ibn Thabit, Mu'ad ibn Jabal, Ubayd ibn Ka'ab, Abu Darda, but among all these, Abdullah Masood is the top person. Actually, people say later on the fiqh became just into two people. You know, in a later, Sahaba, Abdullah Masood and Ali ibn Abi Talib, the two people, and both were in Kufa. So Abdullah Masood is very important in the fiqh. Very important. It's so much hadith from him, so much fiqh from him. But inshallah, that will come later on. I'll explain more about him. Is there another question? Yeah, yeah. Okay, there is a question.
Assalamu alaikum. Sometimes people can articulate the language without having learnt grammar. In that sense, can you compare usul al-fiqh? Or can you draw an analogy there between language and learning usul al-fiqh?
Can you say a little louder if you didn't hear properly? Okay, somebody has understood properly. Okay, if you can repeat, then I know.
Sorry. Sometimes people can articulate the language well without having learnt grammatical rules. Can you still...
Without having in mind what?
Without having learned grammar.
Yeah, okay.
Can you still draw an analogy there?
Sometimes people articulate without knowing the grammar, then what? What the question is?
Can you still draw a comparison between usul al-fiqh and language?
If somebody does not know language properly, but, you know, he has meaning in his mind and he wants to convey the message, and, you know, the audience, they understood already what he said. So though it is a big fault that you cannot express yourself properly, but at least message there, maybe also they forgive you because they think, you know, you made effort. So similarly in the religion, if people, you know, make their, you know, meaning clear, means their ibadah, you know, their usul din properly, measure all those branches, and then in minor, all those things, they did some mistake, you know, did not, you know, whatever the mustahab, they make it, you know, further become, you know, a minor detail, not major details. You know, so Allah SWT can forgive and difference are there. But the main thing should be correct. But the problem is most people are only concerned about these minor details. Like many people are only, when young boys or young children, they learn language, you know what they do? They learn difficult words. And they use them. Do they think if you use, you know, difficult words, then it means, you know, you're great in the language. That's what they think. So that's how some people think, really. That, you know, if you know the, you know, details of Hanafi madhab, that there are 52 sunnah in the prayer, then you're faqih. Though, actually, truth of the matter really is, Imam Abu Hanifa did not know there is 52 sunnah in the prayer. So, you know, it's basically, this thing not fiqh. Fiqh is something else. So later people, they become more and more concerned about these minor details.
Yeah. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. You know, you're talking about the relation between usul al-fiqh and fiqh. Is there like a preference to it? Should one learn usul al-fiqh first before delving into fiqh? As students of knowledge, what should one learn first?
You know, that I'll really not tell, really. You know, thing really is, you know, I have many clever people, when they learn language, their mind works out grammar anyway. You know, when you learn your language from your mother, did she teach you grammar? But mind actually is a scientific, mind is systematic. Mind picks the system. So when your mom says, you know, say some, you know, if the Arab say qala zaydun, zahaba zaydun, you know, akala zaydun, then mind works, oh, when the verb is there, something, mind works, it's marfu, it works like that. So the main thing in language, and grammar is needed, but grammar is something which basically mind itself finds a system, you know, system. For many people, it's easy. They, you know, they learn the language, they learn grammar as well at the same time. That's why you can see grammar is always written after the language, very late. Because, you know, early people, they don't need really. Like, you know, Arab people, they didn't need grammar. Grammar only came in among Arab people when non-Arab came to learn Arabic language. So similarly, the real thing is the fiqh. And people do this thing. When they read the Quran, they know. The mind knows how to understand, how to do. So they don't, like Sahaba and Tabi'een, they didn't have any usul al-fiqh. So in reality, fiqh came before usul al-fiqh. But though when you read, you think, how can we fiqh without usul? How can we language without grammar? No doubt, language never can be without grammar. But in existence, grammar always comes after the language. So similarly, usul al-fiqh always developed after the fiqh. And truth of the matter really is, if you know that I'm going to face a letter, if you know the fiqh properly, you don't need usul. And if you don't know the fiqh properly, usul does not help you. If people just memorize these rules and they never learn really the Quran and the Sunnah, you know, all the examples from the fuqaha, usul actually does not help you. That you can see many people, at the moment, there's no relation between usul al-fiqh and fiqh. Most muftis, when they give fatwa, they don't follow usul al-fiqh. You know what they follow? They are following what we call in Arabic, nadhir, examples. For example, what a new case happens, they want to know the ruling. So the way is not that they're going to Quran and Sunnah and use usul al-fiqh. Nobody does like that. What they do is, they will find a similar case earlier. A similar case. And in that case, what Ibn Abidin has done, what this Mufti has done, if they find anything, that's what they do. So they do basically what we call actually now is qiyas al-nadhir ala al-nadhir. Qiyas al-nadhir ala al-nadhir. They compare a parallel to another parallel. To another parallel, which they know how have been had, now they just make a comparison. Nobody follows usul al-fiqh. The reason is basically because somehow usul al-fiqh has been just become, just basically collection of the theories and ideas. It really, is not so much related to the reality. Though Hanafi usul al-fiqh is still better. Then inshallah, I'll explain that anyway. So later I'll come, inshallah. What usul al-fiqh is, how much important it is actually, and what the problem happened to the people when they just teach usul al-fiqh, but nobody uses it. You know, for many, many hundred years, muftis don't use usul al-fiqh. It's a simple thing. People don't use usul al-fiqh.